This video is a continuation of my series on the 512 vector sequencer. We are going to be looking at the generative aspect of the sequencer, as well as some of the controls that give you a little bit more live manipulation over what is happening. Let's start by taking a look at some of the generative algorithms that are included with the sequencer. You can see here that we've got a part, it's totally cleared out, no gates, no pitches, nothing. So if we hold shift, previously we were looking at Evo, which is evolution. One left of that is generate. It'll build a whole sequence for us. So that's cool. So a little bit more about what's going on here. If we look at the control settings for the part, the setting you probably recognize from previous videos, if we hit control a second time, we actually get a couple more settings that I didn't previously talk about. The two that I want to focus on are over here. So Evo allows you to control the evolution strength. Turning it up to high, it's still not that significant. But here you see gen. So the sequencer actually comes with several algorithms for generating different kinds of sequences. The one that you just heard is this one, ECD1. It generates a 16-step acid-inspired sequence. Now, each algorithm, there's different amounts of lengths and different things that they give you. So this particular algorithm, it'll give you pitches, but it won't give you glide. And it'll give you gates, but won't give you groove. Now, there's a second acid one here. And it's the same as the first one, except that will give you glides. So there you can see in the light gray the glides that have been applied. Same thing, just with a little bit of extra data. We're not going to go through all these, but I do want to show you a couple. So this one, BRL, is short for Berlin. It gives eighth notes, and it focuses on octaves and fifths. So I'm going to completely clear out what we had, because I don't want any glides to stick around. This actually sounds pretty good. Put an LFO on that filter. You got something really nice going on. B56 is an interesting one. The next couple of algorithms actually focus on what's called cells. They're cell-based patterns where they pick some number of steps and then they repeat that number of steps. So let me make sure here. I'm going to make sure we're at 16, length of 16. And I'm going to use this 357. So this one in particular is going to focus on groups or cells of steps that are either 3, 5, or 7 length. So just by looking at what's going on here, you notice that there's some patterns that happen, right? So we see this pattern of like CGF. Over here you can see CGF. Oh, it's actually CGFCB, right? That's a pattern of 5. And you can see that exact same pattern here of 5 again. And that's how this algorithm works. Actually, I like this one as well. These first four are really nice. And even if you don't necessarily use it straight up like this, it serves as a really good basis for either getting ideas or kind of building off of. Just a couple more algorithms to look through. So the next set, OBL1 and OBL2, those are basically doing the same cell-based things, except they tweak around with the step length. So you can see that here on the gate groove page. So this one can kind of get crazy. If you're looking for something different, you want to inspire ideas, I think it's potentially useful. The last three algorithms are RND1, 2, and 3. And these just generate straight values. The difference is RND1 will only give you random pitch and gait. RND2 will give you that plus random velocity. And RND3 will give you that plus random step length and ratchet. So this is just totally random. And then, yeah, you never know what you're going to get on this one. All right, let's go back to one of the ones that sounded nice. Maybe Acid One. Cool. So there's a handful of other features of this sequencer that make it good for messing around with live or tweaking things live or changing what's happening. So this shift button is black, and all of these buttons down here, you probably noticed, they have a black label next to them. And that is, if you hold shift, you're going to get that function. So this first one here, actually, let me change what we're doing. So we had a length of 16, and I'm going to bring it down to a length of 8. So what DBO will do is it will double, it'll take the first 8, and it'll reproduce it so that you have a pattern of 16 where it's basically repeating. Or if you had your sequencer configured for 32 steps and you had a 16 step, it would take the first 16 and duplicate it to the next 16. You get the idea. So you don't hear a difference, but the difference is here. You can see that even though the pitches are staying the same, we have two different pages. And so that allows us to, you know, make a couple of tweaks on maybe the second time through. Neat. All right, you get the idea there. Another one of these performance features, this one here is inverse. And it helps to understand what exactly this is doing. You need to know a little bit of music theory to sort of understand this. So you recall that we have a global quantized scale that's set. So you can see here we're at A minor. So that means that the starting point for this patch is going to be the tonic of whatever that scale is, and it's going to be the fifth one. So A5 is going to be the midpoint because we are in A minor. So when you hit this invert, what it's going to do is it's going to look at the difference between the pitch that's here. It's going to look at the difference between that and the bass pitch of A5, which in music theory land means it's going to look at the interval. And it's basically going to take the same interval and it's going to flip it to the opposite direction. So let me show you. Just look at a simple one here right at the start. So you can see A5, we know that's our center point. We were at A5, and I'm going to move it up one pitch to B5. That means that we are one click above A5. Now if I hit invert, we're going to get G5. And if you look, G5 is one click down from A5. So we were one click up from A5. Now we're one click down from A5. And as you might imagine, if you hit invert again, you get back to where you were. Now I actually think that this is another one of those things it's subtle, but it gives you a lot of flexibility because let's say that you have a pattern and you want to make it sound different for a while, but you want to be able to get back to where you were to kind of restore that sound, invert's a great way to do that. Let's listen for a second. You'll see what I mean. Now, one thing you noticed when I did that the second time is I didn't have that many references that were really close to the midpoint, which is A5. So it felt a little bit more jarring. So one thing I've noticed is this works better when you've either got your first or your last note set to kind of that midpoint. It gives it a little bit more of a stable transition. So yeah, that's cool. A couple more features here. The next couple that we haven't talked about are shift left and shift right. And that does exactly what you would think. It takes all the pitches and it shifts them either left or right. Now, where I think that this becomes the most valuable is if you have a part length that's shorter than what your patch, your part actually is. So you can see over here, we currently have a length of 16. So I'm gonna bring this down to 8. So we're repeating these first 8, but if I page over, you can see we still have pitches here in steps 9 through 16. So the neat thing is now shift left and shift right will shift notes out of our part, and it'll shift new notes in. So as you heard, that's another way that you can introduce variation live and then be able to get back to what you had before. The only thing I was doing is I was hitting shift left and shift right. I was hitting it twice. You could do it 3 times. You have to remember the number, of course, that you hit, but then you can get back to where you were. The last button down here we haven't talked about, this is part mute, which is pretty helpful if you just want to either turn something off. A lot of times with electronic music, there's a process where you build up. And so what you can do is you can start by basically punching in all of your parts, and then you can mute everything, and you can bring them in one at a time as you see fit. But for the sake of what we're doing here, we're just turning it off and back on again.